Okay, welcome to the quick record. In this record, I will highlight how to do the texture bake in the blender. For the checkpoint here, you should have the knowledge in the model editing, and you should have experience in the UV unwrapping, because baking will require the model to be unwrapped. Next is the knowledge in the texture and material setup. So our lab will be very simple. We'll try to model some basic shape, and then we'll try to bake some information out of the our shape. The baking is actually the process that has been practiced in a lot of 3D production pipeline. In the movie, you notice that in the production, you will just kind of start with the design, research, model, texture, and the texturing baking that we are talking about is here in the texturing. If we talk about the 3D modeling pipeline, it actually involves these two stages, UV map and texturing. Let's talk about the UV unwrap a little bit. When we have our 3D model, it consists of the 3D surface, and this surface here are in 2D, right? But our image information is actually in 2D, so we will need to find a way to lay it out into the 2D space so that the painting or the colorization can be done by an artist or either by just loading the image and map on the surface. Then with this all calculation, it might involve a lot of algorithm or complex design to bring out this information. The baking is just kind of the technique that we pre-compute the final result or the apparent into the image file. So you can just say you create the algorithm to render a stone, but it might take too long, or it might use a lot of computational resource to show it right on the surface. Simply, baking means you bring the final visual color out and save it in the texture file. So in the next time, you won't need to go through that process again. Just simply read the data from the texture. However, baking here is quite very difficult to explain. Sometimes the process involves a lot of click, trial and error. So that's why this clip try to emphasize the process easily for everyone who are listening to. I will try to be very brief. The UV we are talking about is the unwrapped data or the face of the 3D surface that we laid out in the 2D space U and V. So the UV mapping here normally a practice that used since a long time ago. It dictates the quality of our bake result. If we have a bad UV, sometimes the UV that are too close to each other or overlap each other might result in the incorrect information. So in our experiment, I will quickly highlight how we can bake the texture information. The experiment that I want to emphasize in this clip is how to bake the ambient occlusion. So let's start with the blender. Whenever you go to the file, it is recommended to make sure that you organize your file first. I will just increase the interface size so that you can read the interface on my record screen easier. I will just turn on the screencast so that we can see the detail of my input. So let's start with the basic shape. You have the tree, right, from the slide. It's just a random search from the internet, and the locality can be created really simple. So I will emphasize create the locality tree in this video. When you add the circle into the scene, set the vertices to be our magic number 8 or 12. So let's start with the 8. 8 are a very interesting number because it just kind of the low poly representation of the circle. Right now the radius is 1 meter. When we test with the ambient occlusion, for now I will not try to be nitpick about the size, but in this case with the 8 vertices, if you apply the subdivision surface modifier, you can also increase the resolution from 8 to double the size, and with enough resolution, it will become a circle. So for now, let's stick with the low poly. I will go to the edit mode. You can press tab to go to the edit mode. Right now you have the option to select vertices, edge and face. I will select the vertices. Select all A to select all the vertices. I will use the extrude tool that you have here. The shortcut is E key. Blender is quite a special program that it lets you work with the shortcut really quickly compared to the other software such as Maya or other 3D editing software. Let me reduce the size here a little bit. I will use the extrude tool for you. I set the parameter to be XYZ and I drag it up. Maybe about this. You can use the E key to manually drag and extrude out. If I use the axis, maybe C, I could also fix the axis that it's gonna get extrude to. For now, I'll use the loop cut, or the shortcut is clicking the tool itself. It will allow you to add the cut at the middle area between the surface. You can also increase the number of the cut. If you use the shortcut, it will follow up with the slide tool. The slide tool here is the menu called slide, which is this one. Actually, the shortcut to get the slide is select the S and press GG, or else you can right click and assign a quick favorite here. Whenever you want to access the quick favorite menu, press Q and you will have the quick favorite menu to use with. Right click and remove if you are required it. So I will just click the S light, left click, and you can see you can drag the edge over time. So the body of the tree can be created easily like this. I deliberately did not close the surface here. You can close the surface by using Ctrl F and fill. You see? It will try to fill in the polygon with the triangle. Or you can use Ctrl F and grid fill. You can also let the algorithm decide how to fill the surface effectively. For my tree, I will not let our tree being seen from anything, from the underneath or from the inside of the body. So I would not need this face, because when you have the face and you start subdividing, the face will be increasing exponentially, right? And this is the optimization that we can have a little predefined process to keep the polygon count low. I will use the S tool, but I will make sure that I hold Alt and left click, select every link. I press spacebar so that the keyframe is moving. You need to be careful. So with this, I will press S to scale the base up. For now, you are free to modify your shape of the body tree trunk. Is this very? Is this kind of a practice that you should not make the line bended or distorted if it does not contribute to the silhouette? You can see the silhouette by go to the solid shading and change it to the flat color. You can see this is the silhouette of the tree. So you can use this technique to measure your silhouette, but if it does not contribute to any shape, it should be a straight cut so that we can edit it easily. So I will press X, Z and number 0 to flatten the axis area. It is equivalent to scale X, Y with the Z 0. You can flatten anything this way. So for now, I will let one every vertices of my T here a little straight. So for now, this is the body of the tree. I might want to move it to the left or to the right to emphasize the natures that it normally not a straight line, like maybe E just another time and scale with it. So right now we have our trunk. So let's finish the cone. I'll start it with another circle. With the circle, it starts with 8 again. It still remember its own old setting. So increase the size here. And then I will move this circle here, GC, to be the base of the tree. We will just form the locally cone like this. About 3 of them would be suffice. So I will just go to edit mode or the press tab. I press EZ and then you can just extrude the surface of the tree up. I will turn on the X-ray mode, and you can see this is the X-ray. So you can see behind the surface polygon. I press S to scale, and repeat the extrude scale, and form the cone like this. If you wish to select everything, you can just left click and drag. Be careful if you didn't turn on the X-ray, for example you are in the solid mode, drag selection might select just only one face. If it just get hidden by another face, you will need to select everything again, like this. Otherwise, if your reason is to select something that is separate from each other, use number 1, 2, 3 to quickly switch between the selection mode and hover your mouse over the selected data, press L key. It will enable the select link in which you can change how they are selected based on the data we have. But right now, press L is very useful. The chip C allows you to switch the viewport from the solid to the wireframe. So I've used this quite a lot. And I will just position the first cone like this, maybe a little scale out. Then I will not close the loop because we don't need it, right? I just like a mushroom. I will just make sure that I press L to select everything. Shift D to enter. After the Shift D, you will follow with the move operation. If you just press the exit, perhaps Z, it will lock the move operation into one, just single exit. And I will just do it again, Shift D and C. You notice that this modeling style separate item or the 3D context into different separated objects. These are not the same single mesh. If it is the same single mesh, it's just like this when you extrude. I will just undo 2 times. In this case, you just can't get your tree shape, but the lid need to be closed. I will just select all of these vertices and press E 1 time. When you extrude out and you have kind of a ring of circle like this and you want to combine it into one single point, you can use the mesh operation merge, which is the M key, and there are different types of the merge you can use. Merge distance, by the way, is very useful to remove the redundant vertices over the same position. Maybe the byproduct of the extrusion without movement and you have no idea. I will merge it at the center and then we got the shape. The shortcut over the dashboard here allows you to rotate around the field of view. The numpad 1, numpad control, numpad 1, numpad 7, numpad 3 are a quick menu that lets you navigate to the front view, right view, and top view. So we would want, sorry for the steam, forget to close it. And you would want to just make some randomness into your tree. Well, normally when you see the tree, it is not evenly displayed, right? So I will turn on the proportional editing, which is this icon. The shortcut says so. The proportional editing is mean when you move, rotate, or scale with any 3D information, it will proportionally distribute the same operation to the nearby vertices. You can also make sure that it affect only the connected part only. Since our model, the three cone here are separated part, we would have the benefit of editing part by part without affecting the another. When you click on any vertices here and you press G, there will be a black circle here that control the proportion of the edit. But even if I enlarge the proportion, you see, it does not involve anything that is not connected by the mesh. So I will just move and adjust my tree cone here so that it retains some random property. It's just like you play with the maybe a cloth or skirt when it's just getting flipped by the hair. So this is how we introduce the natural property in the low poly model. You could even just try to rotate it with the proportional editor, perhaps very wizardy tree. Alright, the next step is always save your file. I will save my file, but quickly like this. Better name your file, right? So I will name it the lab bake 3 model. Save your file first before you attempt the next step. Next, before we do the baking, we will need to UV unwrap the model. And to UV unwrap the model here, we will try to see, we have two models, right? Trunk and the body. You can also bake the information from different part if it is from the different object. But in my experiment, I suggest joining the object together first. So I will select the tree and select the trunk and join by the object. And the shortcut is Ctrl J. When you join, the mesh data inside the object will get combined. I rename this circle to be low poly tree. This low poly tree consists of 264 triangle, which is very low. So for now, in the next step, we will try to UV unwrap. UV unwrap can be done by using the mask seam operation under the UV here. Or you can press Ctrl E to mask the seam. And you just unwrap it using the unwrap operation. If you just use Smart UV project that has been taught on the clip elsewhere, it means you let Blender decide how would you unwrap the object. It's just kind of lazy unwrap that you rely on the algorithm to guess the angle of the surface. For me, I will not use the UV unwrap with the Smart UV project, but you can try it. It is very fast. I will left click here and split the Blender screen into the next part. Right now, you can just change this one into the UV editor. We would want to observe our UV unwrap anyway. So when you unwrap, always decide which is the direction of your front direction of your model. If you're gonna look at the model very often from this part or from this side, maybe the opposite side is the back side. So we would want to hide the seam so that the seam are not easily seen. In our case, I will unwrap the trunk first. Right now, when I want to unwrap the trunk, the leaf here just getting in the way. We will just use the method mesh show hide and hide unselected. Right now, we select the trunk data with the shortcut L, and it just let us select the unconnected part, right? You can hide everything by shift edge. It will hide anything that you didn't select. You can hide whatever you select by H key and reveal anything that you hide by all H. So for now, I will hide unselected. With the shape of the cylinder like this, if you didn't have the lid, the technique to mark it is very easily. This is the front side, right? This is the Y, front one. If I click the Y here or use Control Numpad 1, I see the back side of the tree. So right now, you can click on one lid and hold Alt and select another edge. You kind of trace the path between one data to another UV and mask seam. With the shape like this, when you mark just only the seam in one side, it just kind of you tear apart this seam location out and flatten it on the surface. You can press A to select everything and UV here and unwrap. This is the data that you unwrap from this trunk. You can check on the UV stretch using your middle mouse here to that the interface around and turn on the UV stretch. You see that the blue indicates that the UV is kind of non-stretch and kind of good to use. So for now, I will go back to the front view and turn on the solid shade. You notice that there is no UV to be seen if we're looking at the front and left and right. So all edge to unhide the rest and work on the different tree at the time. Shift edge to hide the rest, and again I will click on the Y or the Control Numpad 1 and mark this seam. You can hold the shift and left click to detect the edges manually. and I will just control E and mark seam. I will just select all and unwrap. This is how your cylindrical shape being unwrapped out in the UI interface. So all edge and maybe this one, press L and shift edge. Rinse and repeat from the back side. Hold all key and left. Always make sure whenever you select the loop, you select only what you need. Control E and mark seam. Unwrap it again. Very good. The result is satisfactory. All edge to unhide. And for this one, I don't even need to hide the rest, right? Because everything is clearly seen. Control E and mark seam. And maybe we can try to unwrap it first. Very good. So when everything is all unwrapped, the seam are not clearly seen. I will press A. And you notice that all of the seam here are kind of overlap each other, right? So you can also press U and unwrap again. It will try to unwrap everything and arrange it in the way that it fits the interface of the UV location. Otherwise, you can also select all the UV here, press A, and go to the UV operation and pack the islands. If you ask you to indicate the margin, a margin is the distance between each UV. Whenever we want to bake something, we want it to be a little away from each other. So I will increase the margin, and you notice that right now we kind of have the UV to be used. Whenever we bake, the bake will bleed, which means it will paint over the edge to make sure that the sub micropixel are actually properly painted. So I will just say that I will move each UV out manually, scale it down a little bit, and I will try to make sure that it is not too close to the edge and not too close to each other too much. Right now we finished UV unwrap of our tree. In a common sense, you kind of accomplish another step before baking. So go to file and save your results. Next, we will try to work with the shaders. With the shader here, you might want to click on the shader panel. But for me, for the convenience of the recorded, I will just split another screen to work with the shader. I will just say that the textures, we can see it here very easily. I will change the menu here to the shaders. But if you have the small screen, I suggest just switch the upper layout. It's just very quick to work with. So for now, when we talk about the shaders, when we want to bake, the bake will be painted on over the texture data. Right now, we didn't have any texture data and material. So select the tree here and create the new material. Just be warned that if you have a different model, kind of separate from each other, you need to bake from each model individually. That's why I decide to join everything. But if you have different model, maybe you can just repeat this workflow and bake one by one. In this case, I will create new model and just call it tree material. And if you want to emphasize that this is the bake data, you can just add the suffix or prefix bake on it. For now, principle BSDF let you see the output in the material preview and let you see the output in the world preview. Without the light source, everything will be a little bit dark. So for now, we don't need anything else, just the materials. Then I'm gonna add and insert the new image texture. Image texture means reading the image information. For now, we didn't have any image information, and in our UV editor, we can't even browse the image information. We don't have anything. You can click new on the UV editors, or you can click new on the image node. I'm gonna click on it. And I will name it ambient occlusion. Before we go on to the next step, let's say that whatever we bake with the texture, the resolution will dictate the size of your file, and it will dictate the performance requirement of your machine. If you use a very weak laptop, maybe lower RAM than 8 GB, I suggest reduce this value to be smaller with the power of 2. So I just review, maybe for the sake of record, and you might not mistakenly bake to large texture. Let's just use 512 pixels for now. And ambient occlusion, we don't even need the alpha, so uncheck it out. When you click OK, your new texture data will be generated in your Blender file. You can browse your Blender file by click on here and view the Blender file. The texture data is in the image, you see, ambient occlusion. So for now, I go back to the view layer. So for now, you can browse your data in the UV editor or the image editor. Whenever you create a new data in Blender here, it will be a temporary data. If you actually want it to be persistent, you need to go to image and save as the actual image. It will be linked to Blender automatically, or you could just pack to make sure that the data is embedded to the binary of the Blender file. I will save as it out. As a result, I will create a folder called maybe lab texture. Try to be consistent, and usually when we have the folder that indicate the Blender file, try to put everything inside one single texture. But for the sake of this lab, I will separate it out. For the ambient occlusion, I suggest using the PNG. So save it as an image. When we already have saved it, we are cup ready. So when you want to bake, you will need to change the render engine. If you click at the back of the camera icon here, you can change the render engine. EV is a hard part rendering. So just like the game engine that you emphasize the performance of the real-time rendering, every calculation will be kind of the optimization process that discard the accuracy in trading of the better performance. If you use cycle, it's going to be the physics-based shading that really calculate all the pixels based on the formula of the illumination. So whenever you want to bake, you need to change to cycle. If you have the GPU support, I suggest change it to the GPU compute. You can enable your GPU by go to edit, preference, and under the system. If you have the graphic card, you can just change and enable the use of graphic cards and CPU. For now, I have the RTX to help me rendering. And right now, when you get down to the sampling indicates how often or how accurate the pixel will get evaluated. More sample mean longer time to evaluate it. If you want to test case our basic scene, I suggest even the preview, reduce this to a really low number in the power of 2, perhaps 32. And for the render, it's going to be the result that you paint onto the texture itself. For our class sake, if you want to experiment something, just 16 even good enough. So for now, I will enable the denoise. Always save before you bake, alright, and increase this value when you kind of see a better trend in your bake result. Don't ever bake a large texture with like 10,000 samples without you even guess what is the result is. You might waste a lot of your time. And the most importantly, the light part here, it indicates how indirect lining will get calculated, how many bonds it will use. Maximum bond is 12, and what is the bond for the fill, for the glossy, for the transmission. If your bake result is not what you are looking for, you might want to increase it to be a different setup. For now, the default setup is good for our testing. When you want to bake, the real star of this lab is the bake here. You can click the bake button here to bake the data. Whatever you bake here will depend on the object you selected, and it will depend on the material that you assign, and it will depend on the texture node that is actively inside the material. So the documentation suggests that you need to click the texture node explicitly. Somehow, if you didn't click it, it's still bake, but might be that the other texture or material just already clicked this texture node. If it share the same data, it might break automatically. But in the case that you might have different texture file and you want to break it differently, you need to actively click what is the information, what is the texture data that you want to break it into. So for now, I've clicked on it. And go back to the render option here. Sorry for that, we move away from the top, right? So for the bake here, if you bake very often, I would say the trick is back it up to the top. you can switch the interface like this freely. So for the bake, if I didn't care about anything, I click bake right away. The Blender will try to calculate and put the final color onto the texture. The color you see here, it is the color of what actually been rendered out with the influence of direct lining. In direct lining, our color refractivity emission, it depends on the light in the scene as well, which means if I just go to the scene here and add the light source perhaps in here and maybe make it a little bigger and increase the power to like 300. You see, there are only one part that get the lining. If I bake again, go to here and bake, the result here might show that there might be some other influence that kind of lit my scene, right? But right now you didn't see that it get different. So I will try to bake again and see, it's still black. So we can guess that there might be some setting that are kind of being ignored in our experiment. So let's go back to the scene. The double check with the model is that I find out most of my students forget to check the face orientation, especially when you do 3D modeling polygon from yourself. So go to the overlay drop down here and turn on the face orientation and wireframe. You notice that the face here are shown in red. Red indicate that the normal vector of the face are arranged that it point inward, and the back side of the surface are shown out in this direction. The rendering and back are actually influenced by this back face. We would want to fix this back face by switch the orientation, or let's say the arrangement of the vertices that form the face. There are several ways to do that. The easiest way is you can click in the edit mode. If you select any face and go to the mesh, under the normal or off end operation, you have the operation to flip to recalculate the outside again. Let the Blender indicate where is the inside and outside, and there are other data to do a very specific normal operation. I would say if I flip on one face, you see, the red will flip to blue. If I all in and flip again, it flip to red, which means it kind of backwardly in and out, right? So I might want to press A, select all in and recalculate outside, let the algorithm help. Everything become blue. So let's just solve this issue and test case it fail, whether this will help fix our rendering result. I will turn off the face orientation and wireframe for now. Select the object, select the texture node, and bake again. You notice that with the face orientation fix, you see the light influence on the top part of the UV. If I want to know which part is this color, in the edit mode, you just press L, select this. You see, this is the influence of our UV. If we don't need the proportional editing, turn it off. If you don't need to see the stretch, turn it off, and you see, this is how our light being baked into the UV. If you don't want the influence of the light, you might want to uncheck it, for example, and bake it again. You will want to re-bake very often. That's why you better start with very low resolution samplings and very, very small texture file. It saves time. So for now, I will just change the bake type. There are many information that you can bake right now. So if I go to the ambient occlusion, you notice that there are not many options to be baked. And there is a bake from multi-res, which is the modifiers. and there is the selected to active, which means you can have two objects, and you might want to make the information from this one, the active one, and left shift left click here. You notice that there are two data showing here. This is the selected, and this is the active. The last one you select will be active. So you can enable this option and back the data from the right one to the left one. If you click on it, it will actually back the data from this one to this one. For now, it might not be what you want with the texture, so I will just skip this data. The select to active might not work in every case, so I mean you will need some experiment on it, and normally it would be on top of each other and the geometry is almost close to each other. So let's turn it off. The target here mean what you want to bake and save into. Usually it is our image texture node. The clear image mean do Blender clean up all the image data before they paint a new result on top or not. If you click on it, every time it paint, it will clean everything and start saving new data. If you have already existing data and want to bake just only a specific UV here, you might want to uncheck it out. And lastly is the margin. The margin is when you actually paint, there is actually the edge area that might not exactly tell you where it is in the pixel coordinate system. It might be 16.5, but in the pixel we don't have 16.5, right? So the safe bet is you paint ahead outside of the actual edge. But the size here should be relevant to your texture file. And right now my texture file is 512, so I would not want the color to bleed out that far. Perhaps I would say 4 pixels. So let's click everything on it here again. Click the texture node and click bake. With the bake calculation, you notice that the ambient occlusion is actually the cell shadow. You kind of understand that when the object blocks itself, without the intervention of the light, it actually creates the shadow over itself. So it is a technique that is very useful to let you kind of check the shadow distribution by the cell occlusion in the scene before any work with the lining. Finished, you already baked the ambient occlusion. You can even check here. If you see the asterisk icon here, it indicates that the file has been updated and it needs to be saved. The shortcut here is Alt-S, but if you kind of cannot remember this, you can click or save all images. Any image you have, just save it. You can press right click and add to quick favorite. When you press Q, every quick favorite are related to the viewport you are working with. So I can press Q, save all image. Every image will be saved. In this case, you can test your result out by drag the texture you have into the base color. You will not see anything in the solid shading, but when I go to the viewport shading, you notice that the shadowly black color here are the color from your bake. And right now, it's just a little bit noisy, right? So let me show you something that if I increase the sampling here to maybe 1024 perhaps, let's increase it like tenfold, and I bake again. You notice that the time to bake is a little longer, but the resolution here might be a little better, I would say finger crossed. But when you inspect the distribution on the color here, it will be a little less noisy. Compared to the 16, I will go back to 16 again and click back. You see, there are some white pattern noise showing up in the texture. So the quality of the texture are relative to the size of the file itself and the sampling. Increase the sampling with the small file size will yield a better rendering result, so increase it into 64 at least, so that we don't see any noisy detail here. You see, you never need to use a large number, just increase a pacing a little bit, and then you can observe the difference in the results. I will press Q and save our image again. Everything you have here is actually the real data that you can export and embed it to the other system, such as the game engine. The ambient occlusion is the white black map by itself, so we can even use it as the alpha mask. If you have the color like mixed color here, you can have the color of maybe a blue and the a little purple perhaps. And the factor here actually indicate the colors that you use as the output. So with the 0 you use A, with the 1 you use B. So we can guess that equation is 1 minus factor, right, is going to be A, and plus the factor multiplied by B. So if you use black and white, 1 mean white, right? White area we show purple, black area we show green. We can guess, let's try it, right? White area we show purple, black area we show green. So it is just that we can use ambient occlusion in many way. We can even dictate how color combine, and if we want to convert invert the color, we can even switch the color A and B, or add the node vector, perhaps colors inverted color before you actually invert it. You see, you can combine the color freely like this. You can even use a darker blue, darker green, sorry, not blue, to indicate how we blend the color. You can even use the ambient occlusion itself as a way to multiply the color over the surface area, or even mix the differentiator. For now, I will not just talk about the application of the ambient occlusion too much. Let's begin the next topic. If you want to bake the data, and the ambient occlusion is one of the first data you can bake, let me decide the next lab. We will try to add the color bake to the baking operation. In the same object, you can have multiple material. So for now, let's just unconnect the contribution of this material from the output of the material itself. Let's say we will not touch this material. It just kind of the showcase that the texture can be used to shade the 3D model. Let's create a new mod slot. Let's call it green matte, and let's call it another one brown matte. With the green and brown matte, set the green color to be green, perhaps, and set the brown to be brown colors. Ta-da! Maybe these two colors can be assigned to our model with the baking. If I didn't do anything in the tree matte here, I select the new node. I will just shift D to create a new node here, and just press X to unconnect the data texture. Create a new one, just call it diffuse color, and with the same data 512, but I will enable the alpha. Usually if you bake the color and you don't need transparent, you don't need to turn on the alpha, but I will enable it for now. I might want it in the future. Let's check out something first with the ambient occlusion. Whenever you load it into the screen, it just the grayscale. So you might want to change it into the non-color. Alright, and if you use with the RGB, if you try to, let's say, blend your color for you, but non-color mean no operation over the images. Maybe you want to test it out whether which one show the better result. So for now, I believe for now sRGB is better shade than the non-color. But all in all, we can move on with the color, is especially color space RGB. So click on it. I create a new default color, so I can browse the diffuse color in my screen. Right now it is black, so I will just save as it's out and name it diffuse color. Whenever I click on it, and if I have three material here, if I go to the baking and change the mode to diffuse this time, diffuse have three options: direct, indirect and color. It means what kind of influence you want. You want the direct lighting to impact your bag, or you want indirect, or you just simply want the color. Let's say we allow them all to be here for margin and bag. Whenever I bag, it will just show the final result in this texture showcase. Is this the influence of the lining? If I check the ambient occlusion, the texture is still untouched. I can notice that there is no asterisk icon here. But when I go to the diffuse color, you see there is an asterisk icon here. So it's just that this one is being baked because we click on the texture node. I will just showcase that this is the pitfall. You click the ambient occlusion. You want to bake the diffuse, but you wrongly click the ambient occlusion when you bake. The data itself will depend on the ambient occlusion texture rather than the diffuse color. So be aware on this pitfall. I will change it to the ambient occlusion and save. For the diffuse color, we already baked. If you have the shortcut Q, save all image, it will save your time because every image will be updated with the new save. For now, our green and brown are not assigned to our 3D model. I will click edit mode and then I will press L to select the face of the tree. And we click the green matte and assign the colors. I will click the body and assign the brow. If the color has been assigned like this, you might hope that whenever you bake the tree mat, the diffuse color with the output color, and you would see the green and brown show up in the shader. Is this a pitfall? So let's try to bake it and showcase what is wrong with this thing box. It will say that no valid object. So you okay, double check, click object, click the node, and click bake. It will report that there are no texture on the two material slot that we have, and right now we got the empty bag, which means there are no output from the shader material since our tree mat material here are not contribute to the output. It's just the green mat and brown mat that is being used in the output. So whenever you want to bake something, if the material contribute to the output, you need to add the texture node explicitly into that material. It doesn't need to connect to anything. Browse the texture you want to bake to and click it inside the material slot you want. Into the brown mat, I will repeat the process. But before I do that, I just add it only to the green, right? So let's try to click render and bake it this time. You see the green influence showing up in your texture but not brown, which means it proved my assumption that you need to explicitly add the texture node, image node, and browse the data that you want to bake into explicitly. Click it as well. If I didn't click it, you see, and bake, I guess that it's gonna bake the brown by default because you actually click it in at least one slot. If I didn't click it in the brown mat and in the green mat, I didn't click anything, and in the tree mat, I didn't click anything. If I just simply bake, it's still bake, perhaps. Not so sure, right? But anyways, try to make sure that you know that you click something. So for now, I will just believe myself that I click in the green and in the brown. Right now we have the color with the contribution from the lining that you add into the scene. If you didn't save your file, sometime when you switch the mode, it will quickly fix the stuff. So right now, I just kind of get to the same position that I had before it crashed. Better assign the material quickly, and I check the result in the material review, and assign the brown. So for now, we want to save our Blender file. We don't want to miss our channel like that again. So when we go to the render setup, change the mode to cycle. I will want to double check this value again. Set it to be, for example, 256 might be possible. And then I will put the back here on the top and use the GPU. Okay, double save the file again. So we talk about baking the colors. If I change it into the diffuse and I just simply bake the result diffuse color out, the diffuse color is actually contributed by the lining inside the scene. Right now the margin is just too large, you see the color just kind of bleed each other. For now the texture seem okay, but if you have the issue with the color bleeding, try to reduce the number of this margin. So I will just disable the indirect and direct line out and try to bake again. With the bake in this time, you just say that the light attribution doesn't matter, just save the final base pigment color out into the texture. It's just simply the meaning of diffuse bake. So you can save your file, and if you haven't created a shortcut, just shortcut save all image would be nice. Q and save all image. You simply save the data out, so your data can be reused in the game engine. Another thing that I want to highlight is that when you work with the material, whatever you play with the material gonna be baked as the output, which means this node can be a little getting more complicated. Let's play with the brown man instead. So it will be a little complicated if you just add more texture on there. Let's play with the wave texture. Perhaps if I play with the wave texture, and I would say I would just create the converter color lamp that use the fraction of the color lamp pass at the output of the base color. Color lamp just simply convert the color black to the left, white to the right. You can also try to map it with other color in your zone. For example, I can map it with the dark brown here and with the white brown here. So you could create some kind of a quick pattern with your simple algorithm here. And this is the output that get out from our node programming. My trick is always put the texture you want to bake on top of the base principle. If you didn't have any complex shader, you can kind of remember it is here. So when I try to bake the color of the overall model again, the final color mean the pattern or anything that you calculated will be saved over the UV. Whenever you ready save your data, save your file, you notice that if I duplicate the T, shift D and X out in as a new tree. If I just go to the edit mode, let's say I don't care about the other material, just delete it. You need to delete it in the object mode. Delete it. And simply assign everything with the tree mat that we programmed a moment ago. With the tree mat here, you can just use the diffuse color that you just baked and pass it as the output instead. The new tree or the baked one here doesn't need to calculate any complex noise shader node, color lamp or anything. It just simply read the data that you baked and show as the output. So let's say it's just much more optimized in terms of computation. It might waste a lot of storage in the sense. And this is the fully node. I would just taxonomy it like a fully node calculation. So you kind of save your time while pre-calculate and save the output like this in the texture. So this is our second lab. And the third lab is about the normal mapping. With the normal mapping here, I would dedicate another video for this. So for now, let's hope that you understand that you can have one object that have different type of the material setup. The thing that they need in common is they need a texture node that you can bake the output of different data out. It could be just only these two nodes without the last one. The last one I just simply use to bake a generic data such as the ambient occlusion. For the new node here on the bake object, you just simply read the data from your texture file. In this example, if I just have the data from the diffuse, I could even combine it, multiply it with the ambient occlusion. Whenever you select the texture node, notice that the image browse in the UV editor will get updated as well, which is very useful. So the trick to use it is to use the mix color, and you can even mix two color together. Right now, if I just want to mix the two color, zero mean the top one, right mean the B1. If I change the mode mix here into the multiply, perhaps multiply mean you let the dark color pass, and you let the white color unaffected. So again, you see that we can multiply two color over each other. It could be something like darken. It could be something like multiply. I mean, you can play it with the algorithm here. But if I split the color, perhaps I could just overlay it. Okay, zero mean nothing, B mean using the multiply. So you need to play a little bit. Sometimes this value work differently on the blending mode. If I set it to 0.5, it means you blend the multiply over your node. So you have kind of pre-cell shadow overlaid with the texture, which is very useful. Other data such as roughness or the spectacular can also bake similarly in this way. You notice that when I go to the viewport shading, the left hand side here have the shadow, but the right hand side are the bake color output that emphasized by the ambient occlusion and even get shaped by the scene itself. When you calculate the lining, it just say that most of the model archive contribute similarly, but the right most one is a little efficient in term of the calculation, but more storage required. So for now, thank you for watching, and I hope that you learn how to bake your information out. You can apply this to other type of information, and I will upload the normal map video next in the future. Bye bye everyone.